your sister Cece from Reuniting Women for Christ. It's Saturday, June 6th. Beautiful Sabbath morning. I hope you can hear birds chirping. There's my breeze fluttering through. My window is open. The sun is out. I think the sunrise this morning was at least 6:45, which woke me up. And that's typical of the time I try to wake up to keep my prayer life consistent. You know, when you have a scheduled time, you know it happens, and then you always have, of course, additional prayer time in between. So this week's audio reflection, I know last week I started the reflection on leave, and why the goal is to continue that reflection. This week, I guess with the chaos of COVID combined with the riots and still more unarmed black men and women being killed by the cops, I think as of last night I saw another video with a cop, with a brother down, and the cop have his knee on his neck. So similar to the Floyd case. So we had two of those within the past 2 weeks, and this was just maybe a couple of days ago. I think it was in Washington, if my memory serves me correctly. And I think as of yesterday or Thursday, I heard why the first cop a couple of weeks ago last week was charged with third degree offense. I think as of yesterday, murder charges were brought down on all four cops, even the ones who weren't standby, including the one with his knee on his esophagus. So it has been, suffice it to say, a very tumultuous week. So COVID plus injustice leading to protests, looting, whatever have you, can only mean one thing, right? An ushering of a martial law. And again, whether this is staged or whether it is a natural evolution of what is to come, and it's all biblical prophecy. We don't know 100% the players that are pushing this, but what I do know for sure is that regardless of what takes place or what we can see with our bare eyes, what we do know is that the eyes are in control. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is still in control. And if he came before you, he will come against you. And this is why the hedge bush of protection from Yahweh is needed. Right? So do not move away from that if you're under it. Okay, it's your choice to move away from it. Do not move away from it. You want to ensure that you have his protection. During this time, just remember that your chapter is already written, and thus, I think that should bring us peace. But I think it's important to discuss it a little bit and then focus on, as moms, what are you telling your kids? I know I had a conversation with my nieces and nephews last week, and Pastor Martibu, kudos to him also. He was one of the few pastors in the pulpit that really devoted about 2 hours in terms of what needs to be done from his perspective. And why many believe that the protests are kind of like 18th century, 17th century, 19th century, 20th century, it may not necessarily be the way to go and funnel our energy. While our voices need to be heard, he recommended ways of, and maybe it's a way of doing both, right? You're not subjected to either or, at least not yet. So it might be a way of looking at, let your voices be heard peacefully. Doesn't make sense to loot because they're going to blame the black and brown folks and not individuals who are coming in to incite the riot and to shed a bad light, a negative light on all people. So while we are saying we're going out to march, the individuals who are infiltrating the march, and they are starting bombs, including cops, unfortunately. And this is really serious. So some are saying this is really to usher in martial law. And if this goes into weeks and weeks and weeks, yeah, by 4th of July, there will be a martial law. I mean, Trump wanted to do this, I think, day two of his presidency. Only in a day two, but you know what I mean. So these are serious times, sisters, and the question is, what are you doing? How are you supporting your family? Being there for them emotionally, and especially your kids who want to be active. What is your message to them? So today's message is reporting reflection number 21. Sister, His grace is sufficient for you, for all of us. His grace, meaning the grace of, the way I am. So I'd like to begin 2 Corinthians chapter 12:9, which actually says it, right? It says, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I would rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. When I am weak, then I am strong. So did you notice in verse 10, not only mention pleasure in infirmities, it includes reproaches, in needs, persecution, distresses, right? For Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I'm strong. And I also notice in my faith walk, during signs of times of tribulations, that's when I indeed feel strength coming in, because I allow Yahweh to allow the Holy Spirit to take control, right? And if we're busy being superheroes, you're not allowing Yahweh to be part of your life, so that He indeed can assist you. He can indeed send His Holy Spirit, have ministered to you, guide you accordingly, etc. So that's why it's important when things seem messy, you need to be centered, you need to be in prayer and supplication, you need to be still, peace be still, and you need to find that peace, knowing that all is well. And I will share with you, I wrote something down, but clearly I'm not following what I've written down. I want to share with you an incident that occurred on the job this week, and I'm not going to go into details, but it's something an event that was held, and as a result of the event, this is the first time in my 20 years of doing any type of organizational events, this was the first time it went totally left. We attempted to do a virtual commencement ceremony, and with a few individuals and egos getting in the way, no one really exercised the spirit of humility. As I stated to you guys before, at home and at work, that's my goal, always check my ego at the door. And I mean, unless something's just criminal or wrong, and you're in defense of someone else, and you have to accept whatever that is. But when it comes to certain things where it can work either way, but it's about people wanting to be right, and having your name in lights, and see the glory, and whoa, look what I did, then it becomes ridiculous, right? And it becomes an S show. So that's exactly what happened. And in the midst of that, I'm sharing with you what someone said to me. I saw you on the video, and you look so pretty, or cute, or calm, and dignified, or some semblance of that. I don't remember the exact word. Someone else related it to me. But I say that to say, it was chaotic. and whether it was intentional or not, and somebody said it was intentional, and I may agree with that person in terms of when it went left and the decision of leadership to not to do anything about it really caused it to go flat based on the levels of access. And but at that point in time, I knew that, first of all, I wasn't in charge anyway, right, at work. And secondly, I knew that the great I am is in charge, still. And so I found comfort and peace in the midst of that storm, where at the end of the event, while some folks said, "Thank you so much for standing with me," some folks said it was chaotic, but we knew it was new. Some folks said, of course, some of the chickens giggled and laughed behind the scenes, which is okay as well, because there will always be chickens, right? But at the end of the day, I think my stakeholders received what they wanted. Everyone wanted something different. And whether we had the infrastructure to do so or not, push through anyway, persevere anyway. And that's one lesson for perseverance, but at the same time, it's another lesson in the midst of storm, peace be still. And we need to find that within. And that, to me, was a very beautiful moment. And though this was part of the end of this lesson, reflection, it so happened that it came up at the beginning. So I have to remember I already mentioned that as an example. So having said that, and we know that Jesus' grace is sufficient, how do you find peace in the midst of the storm? Bring internally or externally, and sometimes both internally and externally, right? Because life happens in the midst of a pandemic, life happens in the midst of looting, life happens when it's abuse, people getting sick outside of the pandemic, anything else, life continues to happen. The decisions we have to continue to make, we still have to pay the bills, there's no moratorium on not paying mortgage or not paying your bills to any certain extent. You still have to do what you have to do. So during those times, it may seem very turbulent. So the question is, how do you find peace in the midst of storm? And then during these turbulent times, it may feel like kind of showers, but if you believe in issue with Jesus Christ, you should find a comfort and peace that's needed. The scripture, Isaiah 43:2, tells us, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Right? And those waters can be very deep. It could be knee deep, it could be nose deep, it could be forehead deep, right? But it can be deep. In Exodus 13, 17 to 22, you know the story of the Israelites' exodus out of Egypt. And the Bible tells us God led them in the form of a pillar of cloud. And at night, he led them by fire. And I think about that chapter all the time, and it's such a beautiful thing. So I encourage you to be vigilant while consuming the word during these times. I think that's the only, that's the thing what I would say. You know, folks would say, if you're an abused woman, you pray, but you pack, right? Don't stay in that situation. And similarly, in the midst of this, I would say consume the word, because the answers are in there. And when you build on consuming the word, you're edifying yourself and you're feeding yourself, right? So that voracious appetite that you may have will continue to grow and grow. And the more you grow, it's the more inspired, more you have more of the spirit of discernment, you have more of that. But at the same time, be vigilant. But don't consume your time with looking at propaganda news that they will put before you. And if you're looking at this 24/7, that can be like a mental, emotional breakdown and disaster waiting to happen. So I'm saying be vigilant, meaning, you know, you check on what's going on in day in and day out, you know, or once in a while. For me, it's once a week. And what's occupying my space, my peace, is the word of God, His promises, as a reminder. I cannot watch the news anymore, and I used to be like that a few years ago, including with the politics and everything else. Remember, we have an election coming up in November. And at this point, I do believe, I think the last time I looked at the politics of the news was when Biden, ultimately, I think Sanders dropped out. And this was probably the beginning of the pandemic. So November is still coming. And again, understand divine providence. So if Trump is to get it because it fulfills Yahweh's agenda, then so be it. We still find peace of it, peace by it, and from it. And if Biden was to be elected the same way, you know, it satisfies Yahweh's agenda, and we can still find peace with that decision. Because we know, ultimately, by His grace and who's in control. Okay, so hopefully that brings you some encouragement. So again, while I encourage you to be vigilant while consuming the word, I just saw on the Alexis app that New York reported maybe Thursday or Friday. This is the first time they reported zero cases of COVID, so some victory in that. But we will know further numbers if COVID is true based on the protests, because everyone is standing closely, even though they're masked up. And I think it's indicative if we have no news on it, then we know coming into the hospitals, I work in a hospital, so if there are no new cases based on looting and stuff, then more than likely we can conclude that the COVID was kind of planted and will be replanted again, either for the summer or for the fall. Some news outlets stated that 19 people tested positive, 19,000 people tested positive for COVID. And, you know, for those of you who are still thinking, the question is, folks are looting and protesting, when did they have time to go to the hospital and process that number, that 19,000 people were now infected with COVID? Propaganda? Possibly. Okay? But we haven't seen anything, at least on the front line, and I think for those healthcare professionals that are out there, I think you're better off finding someone who works in healthcare and gauging from what's actually happening within your hospital, within your community. Because I don't think the news will be doing us much justice. So as I stated, what are you telling your kids? I had a conversation with my nieces and nephews. One niece was passionate about writing a letter to her school, and she said a lot of her friends are reaching out. She has a very diverse group of friends, and she said they are reaching out to her school. What should we do? Because we believe, you know, Black Lives Matter. And she wanted to be able to give them sage advice, which makes sense, right? So I did recommend that she listen to Pastor Tabu, who did his sermon on from a spiritual perspective on what's going on. And I think that gave her type of perspective in terms of as a Christian, growing in your faith walk, what is needed now more than ever. And in the midst of everything else, just as a reminder, we are waiting the arrival of our Yeshua, the second coming. That ultimately is what Christianity is all about. Remember, when in the Old Testament of the prophets, they were speaking about the coming of the Messiah. And when those kings saw that star, because of that traditional oral history, I'm not sure if it was written or not, they were expecting the Messiah based on what the prophets were saying from the Old Testament. They followed the star, they knew, not everyone knew. If you were Hebrew Israelite, you were aware. Hebrew Israelites are, it's an ethnicity. You know, it's a ethnic group of individuals, blessed by Yah. It's not a religion. So the Gentiles and other religions were not aware. And the reason why King Herod was not aware, historically we know that King Herod was not a Hebrew Israelite. He was an Edomite. But he was, during the history, in that period of time, he was ordained by Rome to rule over, based on maybe second or third generation, that area. So, but as a child, he did not have access to that oral history. So that's why he didn't know that, what was that? Someone's coming to take my throne? And hence the reason for the order to kill all the youth within that age group. And Joseph got in a dream that he needed to flee to, I forget in the Bible what it is, to back to that. You know? He saw in a dream, and he could not go into Nazareth. He had to go to, Egypt. Well, okay, I was right. So here it says, Matthew verse, chapter 1, verse 13. Now when they had heard, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek to the young child to destroy him. Okay? And so it's with that understanding we know that it's with that understanding that we know that the message, the oral history that was brought down from generation to generation was told, and that's how you know who you are. You know, when generation after generation, you knew what was stated from what your father, your grandfather stated, etc. So, going back to what Pastor DeBoo stated, it really focused on understanding that we're living in different times now, and while maybe in the 20th century the protests work, we've been doing it for a while, and sometimes insanity is defined as doing the same thing over and over again, and expecting different results, and clearly we're not getting different results from the protest. So it's really about, I think, this pushing a movement about empowering buying black, maintaining the dollar in the black community, allowing to continue to turn over in the black community. And that's how Black Wall Street became so successful and became known as Black Wall Street. And actually, we've had several Black Wall Streets that were then burned down. So for individuals who have said, you know, we need to pull up our bootstrap, you know, it's very hard to say when for years we continue to strive anyway, and then we get pulled down, burned down, shut down. It's hard, right? So what do we do now? What are you telling your kids now in terms of 21st century? And I know from my perspective, I see it as, Bible tells us whatever is happening on the earthly realm is what's happening on the spiritual realm. And because we know Jesus is coming as a Christian, right? That's the basic tenet of our belief, that the Messiah was here and he will return. That same Messiah that walked the face of the earth, that historically have been documented in the book of Josephus, we know that he's coming. He desires to set up his kingdom in Zion, Jerusalem. So we know that in terms of our own Christian beliefs, and therefore Christianity showed us in the New Testament with the apostles, who always referred back to the prophets of the Old Testament, as well as Jesus. He always referred back to the prophets of the Old Testament. He knew that he was documented history that was prophesied from Isaiah and Jeremiah and Nehemiah you know, Hosea, Amos, the whole nine yards. So again, knowing that it's what we are seeing transcending from the spiritual realm is what we see played out today, right? So it's a bit chaotic in the spiritual realm right now, and it's literally a battle between good and evil. It's being played out right now. So what do you tell your kids? How do they become active? What is the recommendation? And I say, you are a child of God first. You are a daughter of Zion first. You're a child of the living God first and foremost. And I strongly believe all of your recommendations and referrals and direction and guidance have to be stemmed in the Word, grounded in the Word. And for you to know, get that direction means you having to consume the Word. Now, we also know the Bible tells us in several chapters, including the book of Daniel, when he was visited by the angel to give us the prophecy of the end of times, right? The angel told Daniel to eat the book. The book, meaning consuming the Word, the content, right? And the Bible also tells us in that scripture where, you know, it was sweet, right? And I guess the message of his second coming, yes, it's a sweet message, knowing that there's a purpose behind all of this. So that's a sweet message. But in the stomach, it is bitter. Because ultimately, you have to take that message and fan out. Ultimately, you have to take that message. And, you know, whether it's to your kids, your loved ones, friends, family, associates, whatever, you have to fan out. And that message, knowing that we have been lied to for so many years, and what we have been doing and preaching and, you know, generations of grandmothers and mothers who passed, and I know most folks, the reason why they don't grab this information right away is because they're thinking about their family members who did not make it, who did not have an opportunity to hear the Word. And they're thinking in their minds, if they didn't hear the Word or they were ignorant of the truth, what's going to happen to that family member? Question, and I understand that because before coming to this full truth, my father passed, and then I have grandparents and relatives, so I hear you, but that does not it does not impede on our growth and our faith walk and what we know now, because it's going to be based on what the Bible tells us, that we were blinded. It was spiritual blindness and a result of what was done. And now there's an awakening, and the result of that awakening, we have, we know the importance of doing God's Word, the importance of keeping His commandments. Remember, I've always emphasized, and I emphasize it because I was raised Catholic, and therefore everything that we know, even though we went to church on some Saturdays, we were not keeping Sabbath, you know, total day of rest dedicated to Him. And while you can help, if it's going to help someone, yes, you can do that. But to work on a Saturday and to do laundry on a Saturday, do all the housework, where you can be consuming the Word, doing educational lessons like this, sharing the Word, doing Bible studies with your kids, and really taking time to rest and reflect. Because working is hard, my sisters. But we know that, right? Getting up every day, working long hours, because some of us live further from our workplace. Sometimes our commute can easily be 2 hours. Some of us are working, going to school, and raising a family. And then, like my sister, going to school, teaching, has college kids, has little ones, and was just an angel enough to take my mom during the time. So shout out to BA, thank you for taking my mom during this time, because let me help you. I was going through the midst of the pandemic in a hospital, and we wanted to ensure that I did not pass it on to her. So thank you again. my sister, but we know that a lot is happening. And again, it's in the midst of all these things that's going on. What are you doing? How are you relating this message to your kids? And from a spiritual perspective. And so I think referring them to Pastor Tubil was helpful. And for me, because I'm still on my faithful journey, I can have a discussion like this. But, you know, I really want them to understand certain messages. I will not do it justice because everyone has a different style, and I'm by no means a pastor, a preacher, any of that. I'm simply, I've stated for my very first audio, a handmaiden of the Lord, knowing the truth, understanding that I've been lied to all these years, and thus knowing that I love God with all my heart, knowing that I love Jesus with all my heart, that it was important that I get it right. That was very important, sharing and getting that part of it right. So that was pretty much the reason for taking up this mantle and letting people know it's okay. As educated as I am, as much as I was a Roman Catholic, and living my life and traveling and doing the manuals, I did not know. And some people would say, oh, your mistakes are worse than mine, or your sin is worse than mine. Just remember, my sisters, sin is not measured. And therefore, sin is a transgression of the law, but it's not measured in that way. And when we look at all the things that Yah frowns upon, it includes idolatry. So that's everything Catholic. It includes sodomy, homosexuality. It includes fornication, having premarital sex on both sides of the female. It includes bestiality, not the way. It includes not keeping the Sabbath, not God. It includes everything, including jealousy and hate, killings and murders. Not honoring your parents, it includes all of that. So, a few audios ago, I talked about the fruits of the spirit versus the fruits of the flesh. So, yeah, you look at that, you look at the commandments, you put it all together, and you kind of have an idea of what path you should be following. And yeah, it is a narrow path. This Bible tells us, you know, the gate, the path to the gate, is narrow. And I always say, you know, I've spoken about my algorithm and decision making. And it's really simple. If a lot of people are doing it, it's probably wrong. The vast majority of the world, they are celebrating on Sundays. As if it's the last day of the week. Or like some would say Resurrection Sunday, that Jesus resurrected on a Sunday. Again, that is not true. So it's important that we get, we spend this time, get that information right, and with that perspective, we can then take it to our kids and let them know the next steps that they can take, and what understanding who should be at the front at all times, who is leading this charge at all times, who direction that they are following at all times, and that's pretty much for one of us, always. So, as we go through these times, it's important to know, do not fear and worry not. The Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes 1:9, there's nothing new under the sun, right? So all of the stuff that's happening, nothing new under the sun, including the fact that Jesus is coming, right? Because he came before. So even that is nothing new under the sun. You know what I mean? He manifested in the flesh as baby Jesus, and it was all about love and peace and forgiveness. So he came as a lamb. And when he died, it was a sacrificial lamb. But when he comes back, he's a mature man. He's coming back as a lion, as a glory lion. And he's coming back to take vengeance. Because he said, vengeance is mine. He's coming back, my sisters. Okay, so you want to make sure that we are on the right side. Understanding that also our future is predetermined by the creator, by the author of our book of life. Right? We know we all, this is our chapter. our book, and it's probably a chapter in his book, but he's the author, and he's the finisher. He is the potter, the clay. So it's with that understanding we know the chapter's already written, it's finished. Okay? So whatever it is, it's finished. The question is, this is the time and the period if we have nothing believing and you've been called, you have been predetermined, you've been called as a handmaiden of the Lord. This is the time to consume the word, get that information in. Right? And therefore that consumption is what's going to give you the spirit of discernment, it's what's going to give you the wisdom, that's the word I wanted to use, to make those decisions, to protest or not, or to do something else or not. And of course it will come with revelation as well. The Bible tells us that Jesus is coming to reign on the earth for 1,000 years in Zion, Jerusalem. So it's not a destruction of the earth, but a renewal with his chosen Israelites and Gentiles alike. Okay? The vast majority of the people that makes up the world, evil, those who subscribe to do it as you will, following that broad road, again, if you go down the road and there's a million people, that's probably the wrong road. And if everyone is saying that's correct, that's probably the wrong road. Okay, so should you pause before you make a final decision? One pastor was talking about 5 things you could do in your faith walk, and I'm going to share with you. I'm not here to steal anyone's recommendations. And it was beautifully done. So he says, do daily schedule time with God. Right, and for me, I wake up the past few weeks now. I've been waking up sunrise, and in this part of the east, I mean, literally the sun hits that window, so I leave the crack open, so I get it. And even some days, if I forget to leave my shade down, it penetrates right through my room like a light shining, like it's to wake up. It's my time. So I shared with you a couple weeks ago, I wake up, I do some Bible verses, do a little stretching, it is Sabbath, so no heavy work, but, and then, you know, I have breakfast, and that takes me close to sometimes 10, 10:30, 11 o'clock having breakfast, because I want to put him front and center in my life. So what do I do weekdays? I wake up the same way, sometimes it's a little earlier, but go to the throne, face east, go to the throne, then begin your day. And your story will go unfold, which is the exciting part. So daily schedule time with God. Then we have dedicated space at home. I found this space, believe it or not, but now I do not have a big home. But I just decided that this is going to be my space at the end of my bed. Facing east is one spot, and then on Saturdays when I have a little bit more time, with the days off, including if I want to do an audio reflection, you know, because it's not about jazz, it's not about lights, camera, action, it's about sharing the word with you. So I found this place to be, it's right outside, a while, it's not an ocean view, I can see some green trees, so it's inspiring. This reminds me of the Creator when I speak and I see it. Seeing is believing as well. So seeing the beautiful shade of green of leaves, hearing the birds chirp, seeing the butterflies go by, even the beautiful bee, the shades of black and yellow, and then the sun penetrating. You can't actually get a sun Saturday, except you sit down and have breakfast as well, right? It's a beautiful thing. So this is my dedicated space and spot in addition to the foot of my bed. Commit to consuming the word, which is what we try to do, in addition to the audio. At work, if I'm walking, now I have to take the stairs just because there's less people on the elevator and you're still kind of in COVID prevention mode. So take the stairs, put my little headset on, listening to some encouraging words, listening to some pastors, some of my favorite audio lessons, including just reading the Bible, listening to the Bible audio. So that's time during the day. Sometimes at lunch is a quiet space, healing garden within the workplace. That was really created by Pastor Reverend Reed. So big up to Reverend Reed for installing our healing garden. And so bench, quiet time, trees, beautiful flowers, birds. So we go there, listen to the word if I'm not chatting with a couple of friends. So we commit to consuming the word. Scripture tells us consuming the word is sweet, but bitter. I think I went through that. And it's bitter because you have to tell, as a handmaiden of Yahweh, you have to tell what you know. Because the reality is a lot of people still don't know. So you have to fan out. You got to tell you what it is. As a mom, you start with your kids. Now, if they have a certain age and they're used to certain things, I know the reception was always the best. When I first saw my family, it was like, okay. But a couple sisters came in and we basically walked, but I knew that in speaking to the moms, eventually the kids would get it, you know. And what I needed to do was to continue my walk, nevertheless. And to me, the end of this was the discussion started with my nieces and nephews, is when I did not set up for Christmas. At some point I had to make that break. I did not do Christmas this year, in 2019, and did not do Easter in 2019, or this year. I celebrated Passover and just celebrated Pentecost. Why? Because that's what's in the Bible. And to be a Bible Christian, following the Word of God, and even though some folks say some passages, some books might have been deleted and omitted and pulled, that's true, but I do believe that if God created the world, the heavens and the earth, that was also part of the plan. And he also is aware of that. And I know some brothers are beginning to read other books, and I do believe those are some of the other books, because it links to the Bible. But everyone has a role in their faith walk. So that's why it's important not just to focus on one person and say, this person's my pastor, or this person, because different people during this time, especially during this time, will have different callings and messages. And putting it all together, that's one of the things I respect from the research process through the doctoral program. It really showed me how to take 100 different pieces to get that one part. And it really strengthens everything from that one point, right? It's just like spokes coming down to this one point right there. And the one point is the Bible, right? Because it wasn't entirely lost. And why some of the words have been changed, I've seen some of the online Bibles as well. They change some of the languages. There's a scripture where it talks about a man and a woman laying in bed and one person will be taken up. And on the online version has two men laying on the bed. No. Really. And that's how serious it is, sisters. And so, can't make it up. Can't make it up. But at the end of the day, again, once you consume the word, you get to speak to your kids, you get to speak to your friends, and that's the way it goes. And let God use you, but ultimately, His Holy Spirit will do the rest. Number four is pray, because prayer changes everything. Have a daily prayer life. For me, morning, night, and right throughout the day. Even it means me saying, like the Psalms that I was raised on, still very powerful. One of my favorites to date is The Lord is My Shepherd. While I'm driving, I'm listening to and saying the battle ready prayer, which I think is very powerful. It's like all the scriptures of protection combined and presented in a 17-minute prayer. That's very powerful. If you don't have it, you could send me an email, and I'll be happy to forward to you to your email at YHWFC2@yahoo.com. Reigniting Women for Christ 2@yahoo.com. And the fifth one is open your heart and beg without ceasing and follow the commandments. It's important to note that I added follow the commandments because Psalm 89:34 says, the covenant I will not break. And again, the covenant is perpetual, my sisters. That was one of the biggest conspiracies, saying that Sunday is the new, it's the seventh day, and then now it's the day that Jesus resurrected. That's one of the biggest lies that was given to us that really placed us in a downward spiral, going all the way down. Jeremiah 16:19 says, surely our fathers have inherited lies. And that's exactly what we've been given throughout the years, and intentionally. Now, not by our parents, because I do believe your hearts were in the right place, and I do believe if they knew better, they would have done better. But again, that's very biblical prophecy in terms of spiritual blindness. And you will not be responsible for that, because we received the spiritual blindness based on our forefathers, right? So now that we are now being awakened, and some kids would say we woke, now we have to use that and move forward. And, you know, we speak to our moms all the time, and then we do our worship and prayer. We bring her in the mix as well, because it's kind of hard. 50 years of Hail Mary and prayer to St. Anthony and the whole blasphemy, it's when you think about it, it's almost hurtful. But like I've conveyed to my sisters, yeah, you can choose to be hurtful, mad, and get stuck in one space, or sometimes you just have to destroy to the back and move forward. And that's what I've done. Rather than stay angry in one place, I've just managed to push forward and not think about it, unless I use it as an example in our discussion. So what are the lies you say? So Sunday worship on a Sabbath, that it's okay. Some pastors would say, well, let's worship every day. That's again another lie. You have to stand for the truth, because you'll fall for anything. And that's what we have done throughout the years. Easter or Resurrection Sunday, that's a lie. You know, the Bible clearly tells us that when Mary ran to the grave before it was dark, right before sunlight, it was still dark. So it was on the way, on the going into the next day, but it wasn't there yet. When you go into something, you haven't arrived there yet. And I'm not sure whether the translation was difficult to put in, because that's a line that most people misinterpret. And that's why I say English is sometimes a very difficult language. So I'm not sure if it was complex, it was written in a complex way to fool people and to continue the conspiracy, or whether it was just a misunderstanding of the original Hebrew text. But when you're on your way to something, you're not at your destination. You're on your way. That means you're still in your previous spot, and it's a journey. But if your destination is when you get there, right? So I think in a lot of Bibles, it's described that this occurred when it was on its way to Sunday, the first day of the week. And I explained to a colleague of mine during one of the we had a night tour together, and I explained to him that, you know, if I'm on my way in earning my bachelor's, I haven't got my bachelor's. I'm still without a bachelor's degree until I earn it, right? And of course, during this time of the COVID pandemic, all institutions, gave their graduates an early graduation for the sake of saving lives. And that's an option for us as well. I hopefully understand what I'm saying with that. Another lie is, when you die, you go to heaven. The Bible tells us that you're blessed. And you have many examples in the Bible where Jesus himself resurrected people, and his words were, the person is just asleep. So, yeah, your physical body returns to the dust, but your soul is at rest. It doesn't return to heaven. Now, there's debate about the term rapture. Rapture itself is not in the Bible, but it's the meaning of rapture, the way it's used, is going up in a twinkling of an eye, right? You're going up. But the Bible says that while you're going up, you'll be meeting Jesus when he and his angels and his army are on his way down. So at some point in time when you're on your way up, you meet midair and you'll be carried to his desired place, Zion or Jerusalem. And when he places the rest on Jerusalem, boom, you know that the earth, the mountains will shake as a result of that. But the word that the most Christian communities use and Sunday worshippers use as rapture, it's like you're going all the way to where God is seated, where God is right now and Jesus is right now. You know, God is on the throne, Jesus is seated at his right hand. He said, "You sit right here, my son, and I'll make your angels your footstool until the right time." So we're not going up to where God is. Jesus desires to come down to go to east, to Zion, Jerusalem. So even if you look at the Bible and it talks about, there's a period of time the dead will rise and we'll meet him up. Midway, he's coming down, we are going up midway, and then off to the east to Jerusalem. So, but that's another lie that was perpetuated throughout the ages. And Isaiah 66:23 tells us, "And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord." So when his time comes and he sets up in Jerusalem, going back to the Sabbath, because it's perpetual, it continues. So when you see in the Old Testament, Yah said, it's perpetual. And the covenant is written in a stone. And the whole idea of putting something in a stone is to make it everlasting. So it does not rot. It does not tear, rip, break. Well, I guess a stone can break. But it's perpetual, right? That's, I think, one of the most perpetual things. If you write in stone, that's the most perpetual we can get. He says it's perpetual in Exodus. He says it's perpetual in Deuteronomy. He says it's perpetual in Revelation. And in Isaiah 66:23, it says, "And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord." That means the Sabbath will continue into the new earth. I also encourage you to read Isaiah 65:17-25 on your own. What it is a beautiful summary of what that looks like. I don't know, maybe I should get into it. It's a beautiful summary. I don't want to make this, it's already getting close to an hour, my sisters. But yeah, if you go to Isaiah 65, I love reading it, so I think I'm going to read it. You can always pause and come back if this is too long. So, for those who are hanging in, I appreciate you hanging, but this is good. Listen to this. 65:17-25. "Behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered or come to mind." It means all of this will be forgotten. "But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as a rejoicing and her people a joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people. The voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her. nor the voice of crying. Amen. No more shall an infant from here live but a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days. For the child shall die 100 years old, but a sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruits. Kudos, gardeners. Kudos to you. They shall not build and another inhabit. That means we don't have to labor and then someone else pushes us out. They shall not plant and another eat. That means we will not be growing someone else's vineyard or garden. Okay, our Mexican friends will not be growing someone else's garden for them trying to sit put and build that wall. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people, and my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth children for trouble, for they shall be the descendants of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. It shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer, and while they are still speaking, I will hear them. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together, the lion shall eat straw like the ox, and thus shall be the serpent's food. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Amen. Love it. Two thumbs up. That's beautiful. That's the description of the new world. And that brings me joy. So that's what we're leading towards, right? So all of this crap. Distant memory will not even be remembered. Cleaned away. White, fresh start. 1 Corinthians 10:21 says, you cannot drain the cup of God and of demons. This is important for those of us who are starting our faith walk, continuing our faith walk, or been doing it a while. Don't get weary, my sisters. I encourage you that you continue to move forward. And I would say that, again, you cannot worship gods, two masters, and this thing, it says you can't drink the cup of God and of demons. So if the world is of Satan, not of God, your goal is to come out of it as much as possible. Limit your eyesight to what's going on, the crap that's on television. Consume the word. If you're creative, create your own movies. And share with other communities that are alive, you know? And if and when the churches, the congregation reopens, do the same thing as well. Find a venue for the children within your congregation to find fulfilling ways to enjoy their time here. And that is a beautiful squirrel. And find a way to do so, because you cannot drink the cup of God and demons. And the question is, well, how do you do that? That's something you have to figure out. I know what I decided to do. This time out there, if I have to work, if I have to buy groceries, then what I have to do. You know, if the movie theaters reopen, you're not going to see it. Because I know now what they're putting before me is a setup. Right? And everything else in between. You know? Spend time trail walking, going to the beach, you have a pool, backyard, family time, of course, all of that is great. But not of the world. You want to limit that access as much as possible. I can go on and on about Yahweh's promises that do not return void, and understand whatever he places in this word and all those other areas that will probably be pulled out intentionally. The main ones are here. His words, his promise, do not return void. So this week on the surface was kind of tough. I shared at the beginning, I'm not going to go into it, but ultimately someone, one of the big wigs, said to me, you know what, I'm glad it happened. And my testimony to you is, I was thinking the same thing. In my mind, I was like, I'm glad this happened. Because for me, from my perspective, where I was sitting, when it happened, and a couple of big people were in the room, including the CEO and the senior vice president of the corporation, who has the ears of the president. That's how big it is, right, guys? But I'm glad it happened, because what it illuminated is the shenanigans that's within a workplace. If you want to translate that in the research world, is that the toxic, negative organizational culture that will allow someone to say no to an important event to a group of individuals who have really been our heroes and made it and personalized it and weaponized it to the point that the CEO looked poorly as an organization and his leadership in front of a very important person. Yeah, that's organizational toxicity and negativity. Because no one should feel comfortable making that decision, not thinking whether they will have a job tomorrow. And too far many people did it, and I know that's kind of a known way of work. So for those of you in the workplace who sees this, you know where I'm coming from. But that's that. And I sat there and I said to myself, the guests that we had looking at this would see it for what it is. How could he not? How could he not? But, so when I spoke to this bigwig, and the bigwig says, yeah, I'm glad it happened. Those were my exact sentiments in my mind, which I never conveyed to anyone. And when that person said it, again, testimony of one or two or more, right? So that gave me confirmation that I was used in a way by Yahweh, the great Yahweh, the father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to send a message to my organization. And even though me, myself, and I, as an employee, may not have been in the best light at that moment, it was like trial by fire. So, in the midst of that storm, from my perspective, I didn't get wet, because he had his arm over me. He had a shield of protection over me. You know, and I knew going into that event that it wasn't going to be a good event. Just because the writing was on the wall. And I could have easily called out. I didn't. I walked in anyway. I tried to help as much as I can anyway. I did the right thing anyway. And still this happened. And I went through it anyway. And I sat through it anyway, for 2 hours anyway, held my head up high anyway, because I knew, and I know, I did my best with what I had anyway. That's living in the spirit walk, faith walk, living in the child of God, and being a maid servant. And when I got home, when I conveyed message to my sister, my niece, I realized that so much was bubbling up inside, I laughed hysterically for about 3 minutes. I couldn't even get to explain to them fully what happened. Because at the end of the day, it's like, who does that? But to God be the glory, because again, I'm glad it happened, because it sent a different message. Now, folks are diving, jiving somewhere, and yeah, you know when you come in the room, the roaches scatter, and you put on the light, yeah. For the rest of the week, folks were having their say, and I saw my CEO about 4 times. Yesterday, and I said hi, how are you? God be the glory. Also this week, my mom was a little bit under the weather, but I think my sisters and I also, with a faith understanding that our chapter is already written, I remember conveying this to a friend of mine who was really panicking at the beginning of the pandemic. And I said, listen, our chapter's already written. If it's for us to go during the COVID, it's for us to go. If it's our time, it's our time. Other than that, don't panic unnecessarily. Just take the proper precautions like everyone is recommending. But if it's our time, it's only our time, right? So my mom right now is a little bit under the weather. I think we make a decision as a family to still keep her out of the hospital anyway. But, you know, by God be the glory, she can still walk, a little bit of slurred speech, but very alert. She understands everything. She can raise her hands and stuff like that. So we're doing, my sister, again, thank you, BA. She's the one that right now, under her care, doing a little bit of exercise, you know, with her, and giving her the support, and giving her some of the tools that we need. And hopefully by July she'll be back home with me. But on that end, it was a little bit where, you know, we wanted to double check and make sure she's okay during this time. So I say that to say things happen between work and home. Things happen when outside is still happening. So we really have our plate full, my sisters. So the goal is to, if you spend more time in the work, if you spend more time, for me, it's all your reflections. You can do anything. Everyone has a different form. This has been helpful to me, and I hope that, again, if it's one person that have been changed by this message from the beginning of reigniting women for Christ, I would have served my purpose. Because this isn't about quantity, but carrying a message through. And understand you'll always have a support system. If you have any questions or concerns, and your eyes are beginning to be like, I didn't know that. That's okay, I didn't know that either during that time. And you know, I would recommend you go through my audio reflections because that's what it's there for. And relate it to your life and see how that plays in. But other than that, knowing that the truth shall set you free. And that's where we're here. So Pastor Tabu would say, at this point in time, if you have your faith in your Savior, it's important that you do love Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And that's basis of Christianity. So when I speak to brothers and sisters, but mainly my sisters, and say that I'm keeping the Sabbath, and I'm keeping Passover, and I'm keeping Pentecost, these are not Jewish holidays, or it's not a Jewish Sabbath, it's the Lord's Sabbath. He created it, it was a gift to us, okay? He had Sabbath from the very creation of earth on day seven. And all others in the Bible is referred to as the Lord's Sabbath. So if you believe Jesus is your Lord and Savior, it's the Lord's Day. It's not a Jewish holiday. Nothing against my Jewish brothers and sisters, but it's the Lord's Day. And for us Christians who believe that Jesus Christ came in flesh, manifested, died and resurrected, and is again by his Father, and his Father says, sit here until I've made your enemies the enemies your footstool, right? Understanding that that same baby who died at age 33 and resurrected is returning, and that's the foundation of Christianity, brothers and sisters. So at the end of the day, if you believe that Jesus died and he's coming again, that's the foundation of Christianity. And when Jesus walked the face of the earth, he also kept the Sabbath. He helped and he did good on the Sabbath. And that's where the Pharisees were trying to condemn him. But he said, wouldn't you not pull out your donkey on the Sabbath? If the donkey was falling off a cliff, I'm paraphrasing. You know, wouldn't you not heal or help someone? You know, will I not go to my mom if my sister said I need her to go X, Y, and Z because I need this and that on the Sabbath? And that's where Jesus defined it further and said, it's okay. But you still keep your Sabbath, you know. You don't keep the Sabbath to do, and I tell folks, keeping the Sabbath is this. If you're keeping the Sabbath just to relax and chill for you, that's the wrong way of keeping the Sabbath. You should keep the Sabbath and acknowledge him for all his ways. Use it for study time. Use it for prayer time. Use it for time to go closer with him. And that means abandoning everything else, because based on the directive from the Lord, any other work, like household work and chores and fire, etc., it's time to spend the week with him. He understands 6 days a week we have to go out and do what we have to do. But on the seventh day, it's his day. And again, let's go back to the original, the creator, right? The creator, he decides, he dictates, we don't. It's not man's law, my sisters. And if you're operating on a man's law, yeah, continue with a Sunday and everything that man's changed. Because the Bible also tells us times and seasons have changed by then. But I urge you in preparation for his second coming, you will draw closer to him. And the recommendation is always to do his will. So I would conclude by saying, Yahweh, your Lord and Savior, and of course repent. Redemption is close, right? Buckle up, my sisters, buckle up. And when you buckle up, know that there's comfort in knowing who you are and who's you are, and whose trap you're wearing, right? I will conclude with Revelation 22:13, saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. You have a great Sabbath. Hopefully this lesson was edifying. I was planning to do a nice walk, but this lesson took longer than it needed to, so I'm just going to do a little bit of stretching before breakfast. And so you have a great Sabbath. And again, if you have any questions or concern, you can always send me an email at reignitingwomenforchrist2, that's rwfc2@yahoo.com. Praise Yahweh always. Shalom.